Hello and welcome. I'm Amritanshu Rai and you're watching Law of the Land on Raj Sabha TV. Today we bring to you the Tribunals, Appellate Tribunals and Other Authorities Conditions of Service Bill 2014, which seeks to provide uniform service conditions for such entities. To discuss the issue, I have with me Mr. KTS Tulsi, Member of Parliament, Raj Sabha, and Justice Rajesh Tandon, former Chairperson, Cyber Appellate Tribunal. The Tribunals, Appellate Tribunals and Other Authorities Conditions of Service Bill seeks to provide for uniform service conditions with regard to retirement age, tenure of appointment, reappointment and allowances for chairpersons and members of tribunals, appellate tribunals and authorities. The bill covers 26 such entities.
Chairpersons, members of all tribunals and authorities in the country can now hope to have a uniform service conditions regarding to retirement age, tenure and appointment. The government has introduced the Tribunals, Appellate Tribunals and Other Authorities Conditions and Services Bill 2014 to provide an overarching framework in appointing members of tribunals. Members and chairpersons of Central Administrative Tribunals, Company Law Board, Income Tax Appellate Tribunal and National Green Tribunal, Armed Forces Tribunal, Debt Recovery Tribunal and others are included in the proposed bill.
That the persons who are being appointed or who will constitute a tribunal should be independent, completely independent as that a judge of the High Court.
According to the provisions of the bill, member or chairperson of a tribunal can hold office for 5 years from the date of appointment and he can also apply for reappointment if he has not attained the retirement age. The bill fixes the retirement age as 70 for retired judges of Supreme Court. Retirement age for judges is 67 years and for all other members it is 65 years. The bill prohibits all members from appearing before the tribunal in which they have already been a member or a chairperson. All members and chairpersons will forgo their pension for the period of appointment in a tribunal and will be entitled to salary, personal allowances, including for travel prescribed in the respective tribunals act.
The bills would have included this provision also, that since there is a provision for representation of the bar in the other tribunals, so in the armed forces tribunal also they should have incorporated this provision, that there should have been a representation from the bar for members of the tribunal.
The Tribunals, Appellate Tribunals and Other Authorities Conditions Services Bill 2014 is expected to be an umbrella law covering appointments of all members in all such entities. All existing provisions relating to appointment and entitlements of existing act will be replaced by this law. Government has introduced a bill in pursuant to the order passed by Supreme Court on 4th December 2012. In a petition filed by Rajiv Garg, court has asked the government to provide uniform service conditions.
A report submitted by the Law Commission warned the government to make several changes in the bill. One such change is a provision to create a National Tribunal Council or a National Tribunal Commission in line with United Kingdom to oversee the implementation of the provisions of the bill. As on today, the bill do not have any provision relating to this. With camera person Ashwini, Rajkamal Rao, Rajya Sabha TV.
The bill specifies different ages for retirement for members of tribunals based on previous posts held by them. The rationale behind such differentiation between members qualified to serve on the same tribunal is unclear. So I would like to bring you in to this straight away. It's unclear why this age difference has been provided.
You see, age difference is provided because there are different sources from which the members used to come. And those members which came from the position of a judge of the Supreme Court, they had one particular age for retirement over there, and then to give them a tenure of at least 5 years, the 70 years was prescribed for them. High courts, again, 5 years, because they don't want to give them 7 years, otherwise they will become more senior. Mm-hmm. Now, that was the reason why there were separate ages prescribed. And number of persons who appeared before the committee, including the chairman of the Law Commission, they were very certain about this, that there is no rational basis for having different ages of retirement. There should be... There were 2 points made by Justice Shah. Mm-hmm. The first was that we must have the reduce the average age of the members of the tribunals and the chairman of the tribunal. And so therefore that can only be achieved by going in for direct recruitment from amongst the bar or the serving officers or serving judges. Unless there is, because there is huge pendency in almost every tribunal.
Right.
And you cannot curtail that pendency unless you get people with younger age who have more vigorous approach to disposal of cases.
Issues.
Death pendency. And then Justice Shah was very categorical in his view that there is no logical justification for prescribing different ages for retirement. So age of retirement should be uniform. The recruitment should be earlier. At the moment, members who are appointed from the bar, they get 5 years tenure.
And
5 years tenure, after 5 years, where are they going to go? They have already burnt their boats with the bar. With the result that you don't get many lawyers. Now, according to the proposed thing, from whichever source you come, your age as a member will be 67, for a chairman it will be 70.
Right.
That's the recommendation of the select committee based on the Law Commission. Law Commission gave us a very scholarly review of position in all countries, other countries. So if we want tribunals to deal with the matters with greater expedition than the courts, that was the only rationale why the tribunals were created. We must have younger people with longer tenures.
I'll get Justice Tandon there. Justice Tandon, your point of view on the issue.
My point of view is very clear. For a short time, if the tribunal is appointing a chairperson or a member, that will not be good. Because I have seen the report of Justice Shah. His Lordship has very categorically mentioned that if a chairperson or a member is given a shorter time, he will not be able to give justice to that tribunal also. Therefore, uniformity of service should be as 70 years. There should not be any distinction of any 65 or 67. Uniform 70 years should be there for a high court judge, either he comes in the tribunal or in the Supreme Court judge. Just like you take the example of the National Human Rights Commission and National Consumer Forum.
Yes.
The age is 70 years. Why not in other tribunals also? I may just give the example to you. I retired in 2008 from the Nainital High Court.
Correct.
Thereafter, the government has taken at least 8 months' time to provide me the central the cyber appellate tribunal.
Right.
And the process is so difficult. Process is so difficult that it takes longer time by the government of India to finalize this said matter. Then in February 2009, I joined as an appellate authority under the Information Technology Act under the cyber crimes. And then my period expired in 2011.
So you were not able to contribute?
Yes, the actual I was not able to see. I have left at that time, I have left 9 appeals. Now yesterday I went to the cyber appellate tribunal and inquired from the registrar. 46 appeals are pending.
Right.
There is no chairperson after me.
Sir, I'll get on to the next issue, sir.
Yes.
The reappointment issue.
Yes.
The reappointment issue. For example, okay, that the government is trying to deal with and give you a better platform and a shorter duration to make appointments. That I understand. But on the reappointment issue, don't you see some sort of a conflict?
No, there is no bar. If it is covered under that age, if you uniformity of the age is 70 years, if the person concerned, judge concerned, has been appointed immediately after 62 or 65 from the Supreme Court or the High Court level, he can get the renewal also, because that should be covered under 70.
Right. So the government's point of view is that renewal means it gives you more bandwidth, more time to adapt and do better work.
Yes.
But don't you see a conflict of interest somewhere here?
No, no. The provision for reappointment has been held to be unconstitutional by the Supreme Court because it erodes the independence of the functioning of the tribunals. If the power of reappointment was to be capable of being exercised by the government, a member will be looking over his shoulder. What does the government want? If I toe the line, I get another 3 years or 4 years or whatever. So the Supreme Court has held that this is unconstitutional, and the committee has categorically said that the power of reappointment should be done away with.
The Standing Committee on Ministry of Law and Justice has asked government to provide necessary infrastructure, human and financial resources to the tribunals for speedy delivery of justice. The committee is disappointed with the number of pending cases before tribunals and authority and has recommended setting up of a National Tribunals Commission to implement a common appointment procedure.
According to the Standing Committee on Law, there are over 1.5 lakh cases pending in Central Administrative Tribunal. There are nearly 1 lakh cases awaiting for disposal in Income Tax Appellate Tribunal. Similar is the case in Customs and Excise Service Tax Appellate Tribunal, where nearly 1 lakh cases are pending and over 40,000 cases are pending in Railway Claims Tribunal.
They don't have a proper infrastructure, so that's why they are facing this problem that pendency is increasing. They should have appointed number of more judges, they should create number of more courts so that the cases can be disposed of.
Now you have a, let's say a commission appoints members of the tribunal, but once you become a member, who will work out the roster, who will work out the holidays, who will work out as to when and how the judge should go on leave? Therefore, the complete administrative control of the entire tribunal should be with the tribunal itself.
Standing Committee has recommended the government to set up a National Tribunal Commission to oversee the appointment procedure of all the members and chairpersons of tribunals. Committee suggests that government should amend the bill to provide uniform service conditions with regard to eligibility conditions for appointment, ground of removal, uniform retirement age based on the post they occupy, not where they come from. Committee has suggested the government to fix a 7-year long tenure for members and chairpersons so that they can gain technical expertise in the tribunal. Committee suggests keeping regulatory bodies which do not perform quasi-judicial functions out of the ambit of the proposed amendments. Committee has recommended the government to allow tribunals to collect fee for regulating appeals as there is no such provision in the bill.
Standing Committee's report provides a reality check on the state of affairs in several tribunals in the country. Committee wants the government to implement the law as early as possible to implement and provide speedy disposal of all the cases that are at the tribunal's disposal. With camera person Ashwini Rajkamal Rao, Rajya Sabha TV.
The bill does not address issues of bar on post-tenure employment with enterprises that have appeared before the tribunal. No mention of grounds for removal of members and conditions of services of a vice chairperson. I'll straight away get you into this point, sir. Justice Tandon, see, nothing on these points that I mentioned have been said. Do you see it as a real concern or not? The point on if the person or the tribunal head or member moves away from the tribunal and is reappointed in some other firm who has been a part of proceedings of that tribunal.
Yes.
No talk of that. And second, also, let's address this point first, sir.
If the member is working and the chairperson is there, both are at par. Now, if the chairperson retires, member may continue as officiating chairperson and he may continue. There is no bar for that. But the tribunal should not be handicapped with either no member or no chairperson, which is happening in various tribunals nowadays. The procedure takes a longer time, and why the government takes so much time in finalizing the chairperson or the member when he knows that the vacancy is there, everything is there. Just
the point I want Mr. Tulsi to address is, see, the entire thing, there's no mention of vice chairman's role or how they are going to handle the entire situation. Second is also if the member or the chairperson moves out of the current tribunal and is given re-employment by a private agency or an agency outside the government, there is no mention of it. There is no bar on it.
I think there should be a complete bar. There should be a bar for the rest of his life, just as High Court judges cannot practice for the rest of their lives in the court in which they held office. It should be made clear that they cannot seek employment in the field of that tribunal with any private party. There should be a complete bar. Otherwise, human nature,
you know how
is,
it happens. I get the point, how the entire thing pans out. On the second issue, sir, the vice chairperson's role, no, the bill doesn't address.
Vice chairman is, for each bench, one of the persons is designated as the vice chairman. So he is the person who prepares a roster, orders the listing of cases, etc. So the entire control of that bench, as per the practice, as per the current practice, is vested in the vice chairman.
So this is the administrative role.
Yes.
So on the administrative side,
yes,
administrative controls of the chairperson, the bill says it will be with the minister. But the rest of the administrative control rests with whom, and there is no clarity how it is going to happen, who's going to decide. There was Mr. Panjwani who was suggesting that it should rest with the tribunal and the authorities. Your take, sir.
Two points I will address. Number one, you have just suggested that the private jobs are being done. I think there is a clause that has been introduced, section 10. The chairman or member who is not a sitting or retired judge or a retired central government servant shall also be eligible to avail the benefit of the central government. And thereafter it says, the chairman or member shall, before entering upon his office, make and subscribe oath. And thereafter various provisions have been given.
But it doesn't address the issue that we are talking about, sir.
It doesn't address
the issue. Bar on employment in the same industry.
Bar on employment outside the government.
Yes.
It does not.
But
slightly, on the administrative side, sir.
Yes.
On the administrative side, you have to
side, what happens nowadays, because I have been to various chairperson and also as a member, without vice chairman, the chairman becomes a dictator. A very essential will be that the vice chairman should be there to control the entire office, to chairman also, so that the complete monarchy of the chairman should not be there. You could say that the chairman completely holds on the members also. Therefore, there has to be a provision of the chairperson and vice chairperson, so that both can, one judicial side, one on administrative side, both can deal with the tribunal itself.
On the administrative control, the bill doesn't say anything. The standing committee doesn't mention anything.
Yes.
So,
but I agree with the recommendation of the Law Commission in this context. The Law Commission said that there should be a central tribunal's authority.
Yes.
Which should deal with all administrative issues and matters with regard to infrastructure should not be addressed by the nodal ministry. Because nodal ministry, if it doesn't like a particular person, they'll just not provide the facilities and make them dysfunctional. Nodal ministry has greater loyalty to the government.
Correct.
than the interest of the tribunal. So therefore, it should not be left to the nodal ministries. There should be a neutral outside agency outside the government.
Yes.
Correct.
Like the central tribunal authority, which will provide the infrastructure.
The standing committee recommends a commission. The National Tribunal Commission.
Right. Commission.
Which should take control of this.
Right.
Yes.
On the issue of what sir said, the chairperson's leave and foreign travel,
yes,
will now, according to the bill, be sanctioned by the government, by the ministry. It says the minister will sanction the chairperson's leave and foreign travel of chairpersons and members. How do you see that impacting the functioning?
When I was chairperson of the appellate tribunal, I was invited at Mauritius, London, Malaysia and various places. I used to take sanction of the government, and the government has also issued notifications that from so and so period to so and so, so and Justice Tandon will be visiting there.
But Justice Tandon, if the government is a party before you, then there is a problem. Because if the government is sanctioning your travel,
yes.
And if it is a party,
is capable of impinging on the independence of the tribunal. And the tribunal should not be dependent on the government to tell you as to whether this is important or not important. What would the government? There should be an independent commission on tribunals or regulatory authority
to control the foreign travels.
Not only foreign travel, all administrative matters.
So basically,
what the standing committee is saying is that remove it from the government, form a commission.
Yes.
But the recommendations may be in place. But do you really see it happening? Because the government, do you think the government will yield ground and allow tribunals and authorities to really become autonomous?
I don't see it happening. In fact, the government, it seems, the present government just doesn't like any regulatory authority, tribunals, or anyone.
To work independently.
They would not even... We have seen, perhaps now for about a year, little less than a year, the chairman of the RTI has not been appointed.
Mm-hmm.
So the government, it seems, is averse to any accountability to any authority.
Sir, what happens if the government really takes control of your privileges, sanctioning your privileges, leaves and things like that? What will actually happen?
No, that will be delayed.
Will that make you completely subservient to the government?
That will be delayed. The matter will be delayed. One has to forego, because if the chairman or the member has been invited for London, he will send the ministry for sanction and all that, then the conference will be over.
Right.
Because months will take by the government. Why not a separate, Mr. Tulsi has rightly suggested that there should be an independent commission for that and independent authority for that, controlling all the tribunals, all the affairs of the tribunal. The internal matter may be seen by the chairman or the vice chairman, whatever may be, but all these affairs of all the tribunals should be guided by a separate commission. Separate authority should be there.
On that note, sir, moving on, my colleague Raj Kamal Rao spoke to senior advocate P.P. Rao and tried to get his point of view.
Retired judges of High Court, they should not have more disadvantageous conditions of service as compared to the conditions they had earlier as judges. Similarly, judges of Supreme Court, whatever you provide here should be in keeping with the standard which they had earlier enjoyed as sitting judges. The actual reality, ground reality, is many persons appointed as chairman or members of these tribunals, particularly judges, former judges of High Court or Supreme Court, when they find that there is no proper infrastructure available, no facilities, no accommodation, no proper staff, and they have to hang on in guest houses for a number of weeks and months, they weren't unsatisfied and then they left.
Thank you, sir, for joining us on this discussion. It's time for us to end the show.